In competitive NES Tetris, I feel like there are three crucial concepts that people most often try to calculate into statistics in their heads when they're watching a match. Two of these concepts have existed as real statistics for a while now, but the third one, which often has the ability to predict who's going to win, I think has been a bit of an enigma, because for a long time I don't think there was even clarity on a good way to calculate it in the first place. Over the past couple weeks, I've been working to try and finally bring an optimal version of this third mysterious stat into reality, and I ended up connecting with several people in the community who put in an enormous amount of effort along the way in order to make this all happen. I thought it'd be cool to dive into the process of creating the stat and the effects of displaying it during an actual match, and in the end, how you can do it yourself. One of the biggest enhancements that graphical overlays for sports in general can provide is easy access to the most relevant statistics, all calculated out in real time, so your brain doesn't have to spend time trying to keep track of them and can focus more on the gameplay itself. And when those stats aren't on screen, you can notice that commentators will compensate by trying to mentally calculate the stats themselves and incorporate them into the commentary. It takes some of the mental pressure off the audience, but it creates more work for the commentator. And you can tell which stats are most relevant by how often commentators will try to do it for any particular stat. At the beginning, I said I felt like there were mainly three of those for NES Tetris, and those three statistics are the score lead.
Jonah's still in the lead by about 20,000 points.
The Tetris lead.
Batfoy's up by about a Tetris and a half.
And finally, the pace lead.
He has burned his way out of this, but he's at 227 lines. Sodium with the better pace right now.
The pace lead is going to be the main focus of this video, but let's quickly go through the first two stats since these all build off each other. So the score lead is the simplest by far. It's just the difference in scores between the two players. This is not something you see a lot of in traditional sports because the scores are small and don't change very fast. But in NES Tetris, when you're dealing with rapidly changing numbers that are often 6 or even 7 digits long, it's helpful to just have on hand so you don't have to be doing mental arithmetic every 2 seconds.
Dao still down by so much, 787 to 421. The number's so big I can't even calculate it in my head.
And this was something that wasn't part of the original World Championships broadcast, because when you're just transmitting the raw feed of two separate console games that aren't connected to each other, the only statistics on screen are the piece distribution counts, which are only really helpful in telling if someone is getting screwed with the piece lock. Starting in 2015, tech lead Trey Harrison developed a program called TreyVision that redrew the original signal from the console in HD and added a score difference stat at the top, which has now become a fixture of the overlay for official events. Over the years, he's also added some fun bonuses as well, such as a drought counter, a burn counter, and a post-game analysis chart. And last year, after considerable effort, he was able to make a browser-based version for the 2020 World Championships online. Next, the Tetris lead is an offshoot of the score lead and helps put the lead into perspective. Since Tetrises are worth 4 times as much as triples and orders of magnitude more than singles and doubles, Tetrises are what's actually relevant most of the time. Knowing how many Tetrises you have to score is the most helpful when one player has topped out and the other player has to chase down their score. The difficult thing about doing math in your head is the value of a Tetris changes as the levels get higher, going from 22,800 points at level 18 to 36,000 points by the time you enter the level 29 kill screen. There's an example of this in the most viewed classic Tetris match of all time, which recently shot to the front page of Reddit the other week.
Boom! Tetris for Joseph! Can
he's
he do
one
it?
Away.
One
he's
and change.
One, away.
One and change will do it.
Since Joseph's next Tetris will be 34,800 points, if we add in a Tetris lead stat, we can see that Joseph is actually already within a Tetris of completing the chase down. He doesn't need any change. And to clarify, this is not to fault the commentators. I mess up the math constantly when I'm commentating games myself. It's really hard to do on the spot. So when I started doing recaps of the biggest online classic Tetris tournament, the CTM Masters event, it felt like a natural choice to add in the two stats of score lead and Tetris lead, which would help me a lot in pointing stuff out when I recorded commentary and analysis for the highlights. At first, for the Tetris lead, I would just divide the score difference by the value of the Tetris on the level of the trailing player, because it was easier to manually calculate that way. But the problem is that when you score Tetrises, you move up in levels and the Tetrises will be worth more, so large Tetris leads would be a little bit inflated. This is the first part where not being a computer science student with any experience in programming really limited me. Fortunately, Zeal, who's done a lot of work to create statistical overlays of individual games, created this spreadsheet where if you enter in the score deficit and the current line the trailing player is on, it will keep track of the level and keep adding on Tetrises until the total value is bigger than the deficit, then calculate the fraction on the final Tetris and spit out the results, allowing me to be able to add it accurately to the highlight reel. levels. And then finally, there's the pace stat. The purpose of this stat is to give even further context to each player's score based on who is further along in the game. The reason this matters is every NES Tetris game has a time limit. On a level 18 start, each player gets 230 lines before they enter level 29, which is so fast that it ends the game for almost everyone, but even if you're one of the select few hyper tappers that can play further, it's still incredibly difficult, and if you're trying to win a match, you'd really prefer not to rely on points gotten past 29. So what this means is that when one player is far ahead in lines, it doesn't mean as much if they have a score lead, because the other player is going to have a lot more time to catch up, and their overall pace might actually be better. One of the most famous examples of this is Matt Buko versus Harry Hong in 2017. Harry Hong presses down, so he typically ends up far ahead in lines and finishes his games a lot faster. He had a sizable lead throughout this game, but after he reached level 29, he couldn't play anymore, and Matt Buko had enough lines left to chase down the lead. So how do you know who's really ahead in pace in any given moment? The only widely available stat in the past that was even close to approximating this was the Tetris Rate stat, which has appeared in Trayvision for the past several years. Out of all the possible options, it's by far the simplest to understand. It's the percentage of burned lines that were used for Tetrises. Four singles and one Tetris, for example, would be a 50% Tetris rate. And you can hear commentators use the Tetris Rate stat as a rough estimate of how each player is doing overall.
Andy's almost actually caught up in Tetris rates here. Remember, he was at 50 something and Andy was at like 90, 80, 80 some percent earlier. And we're in a situation right now where he's almost caught up at 60 to 68% right now.
I think the Tetris rate stat is most useful over a large sample size and can show you on average which player is the most efficient in all situations across multiple games. There's an old video idea I never finished, which was who had the best overall performance at the 2018 World Championships. A previously unused way to measure this would be to figure out who had the best Tetris rate across all of their games in the tournament combined. Before I started, I thought the answer would be green tea. But after a lot of manual data entry, I had the results, and these were the overall Tetris rates for each of the top eight. The late Jonas Neubauer came out on top with a Tetris rate of 53.7%, which was also the top rate of anybody in the entire tournament. I thought this was a neat statistical affirmation of Jonas's veteran skill level, as he was by far the most experienced competitor. But for an individual game, the Tetris rate stat has a couple of issues that prevent it from being a good measure of pace. First, since again, the value of a Tetris goes up after the transition to level 19, it's more valuable to get Tetrises late. So someone could have a lower Tetris rate than their opponent and still come out on top if they got most of their Tetrises at the end. Second, even during the 130 lines on level 18 where the Tetrises are all still worth the same, the Tetris rate stat by itself isn't weighted at all to who's ahead in line count. So to figure out who's ahead in pace, you need to look at the line count, look at the Tetris rates, then guesstimate how much the difference in Tetris rate compensates for the difference in line count. Basically, it's too complicated. An ideal pace stat, in my mind, would give you all the context you need in a single number. So the first idea I had was, well, I want to know how each player compares to the other when they're at the same amount of lines. So what if every time both players had finished crossing a 10-line threshold, you display the score difference then? Seemed like a great idea in my head, except there were two problems. And this game between Dog and Sodium illustrates both of them. One, this was kind of a pain in the butt to calculate by hand, since if you score more than a single, you might not cross over a 10-line threshold evenly. So I had to punch in fractions of a Tetris into my calculator to compare Sodium and Dog's scores at 210 lines. But okay, now that I've done that, looks like Dog's ahead in pace. Except what this stat doesn't take into account is that Dog's been stuck burning after 210 lines, so Sodium actually has a lot more scoring potential than Dog before level 29. Basically, since this stat doesn't take into account the future performance of the player ahead in lines after the benchmark, it doesn't give complete context to the situation. So I talked with some people on the Classic Tetris Discord servers, and they said, well, why don't you simulate the difference in lines with the player's Tetris rate so far in the game? But the issue with that is that, at least in the confines of an individual game, the Tetris rate in the past doesn't accurately indicate Tetris rate in the future. You can be stuck in a dig at the beginning of a game that drives your Tetris rate way down, and then once your board is clean, Tetris at a high rate again. Huffalophagus, however, had a really good idea of comparing each player's maximum possible score before level 29. This is probably the most straightforward and fair way to simulate an equal future pace between both players, basically assuming both of them have perfect efficiency, and it can give you a new score comparison. And to make it simpler, we'll turn it into a score difference, and while we're at it, let's throw on a Tetris difference as well. But even reaching this step was actually a bit more complicated than it looks, because how do you get a maximum score? Do you assume a perfect Tetris rate? It's what I thought at first, but in practice, it's not the case. At 226 lines, for example, instead of just taking a Tetris, you can theoretically burn a triple and still be on level 28 speed, so a triple and a Tetris is your actual maximum scoring potential. So I grinded through a spreadsheet twice, trying to brute force calculate the maximum possible scoring potential from each line before I realized both times I was doing it wrong, and posed the question again to the Tetris Discord servers. And Fractal161 told me the answer was recursive programming that could try every possibility. And a few minutes later, he had written up a Python script that not only gives the maximum score for any given line, it also shows the scoring sequence. Such as this curious example from two lines, the optimal path is to get all Tetrises except for a triple right after you enter level 19. So now all that's left to do is take each player's score, add the corresponding maximum score left on each of their line totals to get their maximum score, subtract the difference, then plug that along with the trailing player's line count into the Tetris difference spreadsheet, and finally get this result. But punching in all of these calculations by hand every time would obviously be a nightmare. So I spent a couple more hours making a master spreadsheet that in almost all situations could calculate everything in an instant from just four data points, each player's line total and current score. By pulling from a database of max scores and coupling it to two separate Tetris difference calculating pages, it could give an immediate clean printout of all the relevant stats I was looking for. There was also an option to specify if a player had topped out. I'll get to why later. So what value can this pay stat add to understanding a match? Here are some examples. In the earlier clip I used for my beta version of the pay stat, if we update it to the new and improved version, we can see it's Sodium, not Dog, who is correctly shown to have the pace lead, even though he is behind in score. And this pans out, as Sodium ends up winning the game as both players top out shortly after level 29. Now, one initial criticism of this stat I received on Discord was actually directed at its predictive power. Would this make the end of classic Tetris matches less exciting if you knew ahead of time who was most likely to win? I'd say no, because while the pay stat does reveal a presumptive winner in traditionally intense games where the score is close but the line count is not, it also makes a lot of other different games a lot more exciting. One example of this is Game 3 between Brendan and Jake in the September 2020 CTM Finals. Jake has an enormous score lead, but Brendan is actually really close in pace. And you can see the true margin of their scoring potential rise and fall as Jake and Brendan trade burns going into the final levels. If Brendan had a way to know how close the game really was, he might have been able to play a little bit more aggressive and catch up in pace instead of being stuck having to make up one Tetris on level 29. So that's a situation where a failed comeback that seemed hopeless was actually on the verge of being possible the whole time. But the pace stat can also work in the other direction as well, revealing some situations to be far more dire than they initially seem and making comebacks even more impressive. In this game I restreamed for Huffalovicus and Paul in Classic Tetris League, Paul has a big score lead but an even bigger pace lead. This kind of difference this late in the game should be nearly insurmountable. But from this point out, Huffalovicus played perfect, reaching his maximum possible score and then some, even managing to gain some additional pace back with a few lines on level 29, with Paul just barely able to win by 2,000 points with a final Tetris he almost didn't get. Huff turned what should have been a rout into a photo finish. So why is there an option in the spreadsheet to designate if someone's topped out? Well, if somebody topped out before level 29, their current score becomes their maximum potential score because they can't actually score anymore at this point, and it makes more sense to compare their current score to their opponent's maximum score for chasedowns. The Jonas and Joseph game is a prime example of this and shows just how much a premature top out can swing the momentum. Jonas was far ahead in pace until he topped out at level 26, and suddenly the pace lead jumps to Joseph. But he's still not in the clear yet, as he ideally has to chase down Jonas's score before 29, and every time he burns, the pace gap gets smaller, showing just how much of a margin he has to spare. I think overall the pace stat puts the endgame into perspective far better for viewers and commentators. In the Buko and Harry Hong game, at one point the commentator says this.
At the speed,
might not be possible for him to catch up.
If we plug in the pace stat, not only can we see that it's still very possible, we can see exactly how much of a margin Buko has available to burn before level 29. So are there any further issues or biases with this version of the stat? Well, there's a slight bias towards the player behind in lines because they're given a larger percentage of their game that's assumed to be maximum efficiency when calculating maximum score. However, I think this is a fair concession to have in the stat, since the player behind in lines does have the advantage of knowing how aggressive to play at the end, and can attempt to play perfect if they really need to. It also shows directly what's possible in the chase down so that the margin is easily understandable, and I find that more valuable than the much rougher alternative of trying to simulate someone's Tetris rate. However, the biggest issue is that even with the spreadsheet to help out with the number crunching, it still takes a long time to generate these statistics manually, since I have to pause the game every time someone burns, type in the numbers, and then copy and paste everything over. It's tedious to do to the point where it only really makes sense to do it for brief highlights and not really practical to ever do it across an entire game. In a perfect world, theoretically, there'd be a computer program that could automatically read all the numbers, crunch the statistics, and overlay them on top of the final video at a single push of a button. By the time I'm making this video, that program actually exists. As it turns out, with many attempts at automation though, it ended up being the hardest and longest part of the process. I started by reaching out to Twitch streamer Yobi9, who had programmed an incredible layout for streaming NES Tetris that keeps track of nearly every aspect of the game that one could think of. I asked him if the program I was thinking of was even possible, and he said, yeah, absolutely. In fact, as luck would have it, he had just finished making a program that could add the Tetris rate statistic to footage from Chris Higgins' documentary about the 2014 World Championships, building off the work that Zeal had previously done with Nestris OCR, another open source program that can read game data from single-player Tetris gameplay. I wasn't expecting him to actually make the program I had in mind, but since so much of the groundwork was already done, he told me he'd whip up something real quick, and within a few hours, he sent me a first proof of concept. But my inexperience with programming was a bit of a roadblock on the way to actually testing it. First, I had to download the correct version of Python, which was not the most recent one, and it turns out if you download the wrong version and uninstall it, it won't actually remove the installation files from your computer, and it will quietly mangle the ability for future installations to work properly. So you gotta remove those files manually. Also, I had to learn how to use command prompt to get Python to download additional necessary code libraries and to actually get the programs to run. I also needed to dive into one of the Python files, generate.py, to enter in the coordinates for all the spots the program would be detecting and to switch on and off which parts of the code I wanted to actually run. All this took way longer for me to figure out than for Yobi to actually write it, but in the end, the moment came where I could see the program churning out stats. It was beautiful. So, job done, right? Well, there were still a few more tweaks to iron out. Sometimes the stats would render out wrong, and sometimes nothing would render at all, and it was hard to tell on a case-by-case basis whether it was a code issue or a calibration issue. So Yobi added two optional layers of verification, one line to show what the program was reading, and a second line to show what the code was interpreting it as. In order to not have to waste time rendering the whole thing, he also added a snapshot feature to print out a single frame for verification. So that at least allowed us to make sure the calibration was always correct. Now there were just a few things to fix with the code. Since getting a max out in competition is relatively common nowadays, in top tournaments players will put in a Game Genie code to record scores higher than a million within the 6-digit display. A is 10, B is 11, etc. The problem is that B's and 8's look so similar that if the calibration was just the tiniest bit off, the program had a really hard time telling them apart, resulting in readouts like this. Also, since the game's creators never expected players to reach level 30, the level displays as 00, and levels 31 and beyond aren't any better. The program needed to read the level the player was on so it could calculate everything correctly, no matter what level the player had started their game on. There was also the issue of some players having blips or glitches in their game footage, which could cause the program to have a null input, or having a faded frame where the score was changing that was unintelligible. There was also no way to know just from the scores, lines, and level regions of the board when players had topped out. So how were these problems fixed? Let's go through it rapid fire. When the program reads an 8, it checks if the previous known value was a 7 or 8. If yes, then the 8 was read correctly. If however the previous known value was A or B, then the 8 should actually be a B. Same idea with level 30, double checking the previous known value. For fades and glitches, when a change is detected, the program waits an additional frame before changing the values. And for topouts, when you're on the stencil, those regions eventually turn into the rocket screen, so when the program detects more than 5 frames in a row of nothing, it assumes a topout. After several days of beta testing and Yobi painstakingly fixing every issue that came up, the program could finally render out entire games beautifully. Historical games like Joseph and Green Tea's first double max out in competition, now I can add additional stats in minutes instead of hours. So huge thanks to everyone who contributed along the way to make this possible, especially Fractal161, Zeal, and of course, Yobi9 for going above and beyond to actually make the program. He's released it as an open source project on GitHub, and there'll be a link in the description if you want to check it out. Now, there's one last thing to address. Rendering out stats on historical games is great for post-game analysis, but the true holy grail would be to have these stats rendered out in real time during the matches for the benefit of the audience, commentators, and players. What if I were to tell you that program also already exists? Recently, Yobi has been building in-browser competitive layouts like Maxout Club that take raw game feeds directly from your computer and redraw them in crisp layouts with all the stats I've been talking about and many more. This program is called Nestris Champs, and it's actually really easy to set up. I was able to figure it out in less than half an hour and co-wrote this doc that I'll also link in the description that explains the whole process. And now I can do things with tons of different layouts. I can have my own gameplay individually tracked with the Mega Statistics screen, and the other week I was able to host and commentate an exhibition match between Miles and Aaron that tested out Yobi's two-player layout, and I could use the pace stat along with all the other stats in my live commentary. Now, the website's not 100% finished yet. There's still a lot of polishing and finishing touches to add to it. But like the stat rendering program, it's open source, so if you're a programmer and want to contribute, or you're a player who just wants to beta test it or offer suggestions, be sure to join Yobi's Discord server to join the discussion. A recent contributor named Robert has already been adding improvements such as merging Yobi's Tetris rate renderer with the main stat renderer to add an extra stat. So now, finally, after that several week diversion, it's time for the next ETM recap. I'll see you then.